Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Death on a Distant Frontier, A Lost Victory, 1944, by Charles Whiting, narrated by Dallas Britt. Soldiers of the West Front, I expect you to defend the sacred soil of Germany to the very last. Heil Hitler, Field Marshal von Rundstedt, 1944. The whole art of war consists of guessing what is on the other side of the hill. The Duke of Wellington. Author's note. Far away to the north, where Patton had just broken through and was driving hell for leather for the Rhine, the night sky flickered red at regular intervals. Over the waiting American line, an occasional flare sailed into the air, bathing all below in its sickly light. The night of 19 March was quiet and peaceful. Colonel Wallace Chivas, whose battalion of the U.S. 70th Infantry Division would soon go into action, recalled after the war. The warming wind swept in front of the south and sent patterns of apples twinkling on the river. In foxholes along the shore, the men looked up at the sky and waited. It was nearly dawn on this Tuesday, 20 March, 1945. Chevez's trailblazers, as the men of the 70th were nicknamed, were about to attack the Siegfried Line on the other side of the River Saar, the Great Wall of Germany, which Hitler had built nearly a decade earlier, back in 1944, when American troops had first penetrated the Siegfried Line on the afternoon of Tuesday, 11 September. The Trailblazers had still been training some 5,000 miles away from this distant frontier. Indeed, some of the men now waiting tensely in their foxholes had not even been in the army then. Those first invaders had found the line long abandoned. The guns had vanished. Dust was thick on the floors of the concrete bunkers. The barbed wire entanglements were rusty and covered with weeds, and the minefields had been cleared. A local farmer had built a chicken coop outside one of the pillboxes. That afternoon, it had seemed to those first invaders that the attack on the West Wall, as the Germans called it, would be a walkover. The autumn victory had been in the air. The German army in France had been shattered, and the survivors were in full flight back to the Reich, a ragged, dispirited rabble. Hitler's empire was visibly collapsing. British troopers of the Special Air Service, who had been dropped the previous June to rally the Mackies, were ranging far and wide, ahead of the advancing Americans, spearheading the route and smoothing the path for the advancing armies of U.S. Generals Hodges, Patton, and Patch. Once those armies were through the abandoned Siegfried Line, there remained only one great natural barrier ahead of the Allies: the River Rhine. It seemed quite likely, as the papers back home were joyfully proclaiming, that the war would be over by Christmas. So, why was it that now, 6 months later, the Trailblazers and other divisions of the U.S. 7th Army were still attacking that Great Wall of Germany? It is now almost 30 years since I wrote the first of a loose series of books about the fighting, which I privately call the Frontier Battles. Since then, I have attempted to cover every aspect of that six-month battle for Germany's frontier, and in those three decades, I must have walked along all the 350 miles of the border which divides Germany from Holland and France. On those journeys, while I've tramped the fields and forests still littered with the rusting debris of battle, I have often asked myself why it had taken the Allies so long to smash through the Siegfried Line. How had it come about that, after that terrible debacle of September 1944, the the Germans had survived to launch the bold counterattack of December of that year. That counterattack, the Battle of the Bulge as it came to be known, had cost the Allies 80,000 casualties and had prolonged the fighting on that distant frontier right into March 1945. Where had the Allied strategy failed them? It is my opinion that the turning point in Germany's favor came during the 11-week period between the second week of September, when that little band of Americans from the U.S. 5th Armored Division first penetrated the Siegfried Line, and 23 November, when General Leclerc's 2nd Armored Division of Patch's 7th Army captured Strasbourg and reached the Rhine. In that second week of September, General Hodges's 1st Army was already penetrating the 20-mile stretch of the West Wall between Bleiow and Sivnig. To the south of Hodges, Patton's 3rd Army was a mere 17 miles from the German frontier, and on Patton's southern flank, Patch's 7th Army was catching up fast. Why wasn't a decisive thrust using all available strength made that September? It would undoubtedly have brought the war in the West to a speedy end. 50 years ago, that question could only have been answered by one man. He was the Allied Supreme Commander, General Eisenhower. 11 days before the 1st, Americans of the 5th Armored Division penetrated the Siegfried Line. Eisenhower had taken over the command of all Allied ground forces from General Montgomery. It had been his boss in Washington, the austere General Marshall, who wouldn't even let the President of the United States call him by his first name, who had suggested that he should do so. Today, we can only conjecture why Marshall made the suggestion. After all, throughout his 30-year Army career, Eisenhower never commanded troops in action. In essence, Eisenhower was a chair-born general who combined military skill with diplomacy. His strategic ideas were limited, and Marshall knew it. So, why did he make the suggestion? The fact that it was an election year in the United States might have influenced Marshall. Victory in Europe might well mean re-election for President Roosevelt. But that victory had to be achieved by an American ground force commander, not a British one. Besides, for every British soldier serving under Eisenhower, there were now 3 American ones. Indeed, that autumn it seemed as if the American top brass were determined that they, and they only, would gain the kudos for victory in Europe. The winning of the war would be an exclusively American affair, regardless of the strategies planned before the campaign had begun. As Patton summed it up one night to his old comrade, Big Simp Simpson, the commander of the U.S. 9th Army, "Well, here we all are, under Eisenhower and Bradley, both 6 years our junior. Hodges flunked out of West Point. Now he commands 1st Army. I was turned back from 08, the class of that year, and it took me 5 years to graduate. But now I command 3rd Army. You came 2nd from the bottom in our class in 09, and now you command 9th Army. Isn't it odd that 3 old farts like us should be carrying the ball for those 2 sons of bitches?" It was this strong bond based on the common alma mater, West Point, a kind of old boy network shared by Eisenhower, Bradley, and Ike's 3 Army commanders, that became the critical factor in determining the conduct of the war that autumn. Each of them wanted to ensure that it was an American general who won the war in the West. Not only did they refuse to give support to that little limey fart, Montgomery, up in the North, who was best placed for a decisive breakthrough into the Reich, but they also competed against each other. Every one of them wanted to achieve personal glory, and damn the rest. In the end, it was America's forgotten army, the 7th, which reached the Rhine first, 4 months before Hodges' First Army made the impromptu and unplanned crossing of the river at Remagen in March 1945. Devers, commanding the U.S. 6th Army Group, to which the 7th Army belonged, at once ordered patrols across the Rhine, who reported back that the bunkers of the Siegfried Line on the other side were unmanned and there was no sign of the enemy. The River Rhine was ripe for the taking. It is indicative of how the 7th Army has been neglected by U.S. historians that the official history of its campaign in France and Germany was only published in 1993, decades after the accounts of Hodges's and Patton's armies. 2 days after the Rhine had been reached, Eisenhower, in a foul temper, and Bradley journeyed south to meet Devers. Eisenhower, who disliked Devers, as did Bradley, and would have fired him if he had been able to, ordered that all planning to cross the Rhine in corps strength had to cease immediately. Instead, the 7th would first mop up the West Bank and then turn and support Patton in the Saar Basin. Even though Patton was delighted by the news, he did confide to his diary that day that, "I personally believe that 6th Corps of the 7th Army should have crossed the Rhine, but it was stopped by Eisenhower the day he visited Devers." Devers protested against the decision vigorously in a late-night meeting which went on to the small hours of the following morning, but Eisenhower overruled him. Devers noted later in his diary, "I feel as if I don't belong to the same team." It is interesting to conjecture. Patch's chief engineer, General Garrison H. Davidson, recalled 30 years later, "What might have been the effect of the exploitation of the unexpected crossing of the Rhine in late November or early December and envelopment of the Ruhr? What might have happened had Ike had the audacity to take a calculated risk as Patton would have instead of playing it safe?" But Eisenhower didn't take that calculated risk. Devers was well and truly stopped. The kudos of being the first American army to cross the Rhine would be gained by one of Eisenhower's inner circle, Hodges's first. Devers' 7th would stay on the Rhine for another 4 months and would be the last to cross on 26 March 1945. So, the long 350-mile front bogged down again. From the top, there seemed no direction. November gave way to December. An irate Montgomery complained on 16 December to Chaffee's chief of operations, General Sir John Whiteley, that unless the Supreme Commander made up his mind soon about what he wanted to do and gave definite orders, the Allies were likely to drift into an unfavorable situation vis-a-vis the enemy. They were prophetic words. On that same Saturday morning, 200,000 German troops launched a counterattack in the Ardennes against U.S. General Middleton's 80,000-strong 8th Corps. The Battle of the Bulge had started. 3 months later, on the dawn of Tuesday, 20 March 1945, the 70th Division's artillery opened up. The first American shells zipped over the heads of the infantry waiting in their foxholes and slammed into the German positions on the other side of the River Saar. The assault barrage had begun. Above the racket, NCOs yelled, "Okay, let's go!" The infantry rose apprehensively. Bodies crouched. They moved forward in ragged lines. Any moment now, they knew the crowds would open up. The bitter killing game they had been forced to play these last 3 months since they had first arrived in France would start again. They came ever closer to the bunkers. In the incandescent light cast by the bursting phosphorus shells, They could see the German wire with the squat concrete bunkers beyond quite clearly. Why hadn't the defenders opened up yet? Out there in the open, they were sitting ducks. Now, the men of the first wave were scrambling over the rusting wire. This was the signal for the U.S. artillery to cease fire. The shelling stopped. The infantry hesitated. The officers barked, "Keep moving!" But the attack was faltering, not because of the enemy. The faces of the infantrymen reflected their sudden surprise. German bunkers were empty. The enemy had done a bunk. They had abandoned their Siegfried Line positions during the hours of darkness. The last stretch of the Great Wall of Germany had been finally broken. The Siegfried Line, on which the Tommies had been going to hang out their washing so long before, had fallen at last. In the years to come, Colonel Chevez, a battalion commander much respected by his troops because they knew he wouldn't squander their lives needlessly, would often wonder why it had taken so long to break through the Siegfried Line. From 11 September 1944 until 20 March 1945. It was a question that often troubled him. Why had so many lives been sacrificed? What had gone wrong? Death on a Distant Frontier is an attempt to answer those questions. 1. September-October 1944.
Maybe there are 5,000, maybe 10,000 Nazi bastards in their concrete foxholes before the Third Army. Now, if Ike stops holding Monty's hand and gives me the supplies, I'll go through the Siegfried Line like shit through a goose.
General Patton, September 1944. 1. Airborne Spearhead. The soldiers who would drop into enemy territory this night had all been kitted out. By 1944, the informal dress they had worn in the desert had been replaced by standard British battle dress, parachute helmet, and rubber-soled boots. All were heavily armed, with a scabbard strapped to the right leg, while on the left there was tied a rope to which a 100-pound kit bag would be attached just before they dropped. Colonel Brian Franks, their commander, a veteran of the war in the shadows in North Africa, Sicily, and Italy, nodded his approval. Most of the men who would jump with him this September night had never taken part in ops before, but they were remarkably calm. Getting on with the job with no apparent sign of nerves, not much different from the handful of veterans he would take with him. They filed out in the moonlit night and waddled. They all carried 60-pound packs in addition to all the other gear, to the specially converted Halifax bomber of the Royal Air Force's 161st Special Duty Squadron. The pilot saluted Franks, told him and the rest of the length of the flight, weather conditions, and what they might expect from the enemy. Then they were clambering awkwardly into the four-engine bomber. The interior was bare and cheerless. There were no seats, only sacks and sleeping bags on the floor, and a bucket.
"Piss bucket," the sergeant dispatcher told them cheerfully. "First man to use it empties it afterwards."
Thereupon, he started handing out flasks of tea and coffee and packets of wads, thick sandwiches of corned beef and hard cheese, standard British Army fare on ops like these. Under Colonel Frank's supervision, the young troopers lay down on the floor, while the former returned the salute of the base commander, glimpsed outside on the tarmac. It was a tradition in the Special Duty Squadron that these daring young men, who might be dead before the night was out, had to be honored by the presence of the airfield's highest-ranking officer. the lights inside the fuselage went out. The bomber trembled as the pilot ran his four engines at full power. Satisfied that all four were running sweetly, he eased the throttles forward. The Halifax started to rumble down the runway. The last of the flare path lights loomed up to the left and right. The pilot pulled back the stick, and they were airborne. Slowly, the pilot started to circle in order to gain height. Franks, sitting with his back to the metal fuselage, could feel it getting colder and colder. But he didn't snuggle beneath the blankets and sacks as his young troopers had already done. Good soldiers that they were, they knew they'd need all the sleep they could get before the fun and games began. Frank's mind was too full of the mission to come. His task was to lead his unit, the 2nd SAS, the Americans who occasionally served with them called them in a good-natured fashion, the sad athletic sacks, into action behind the German lines in France's high Vosges Mountains, some 60 miles from the old French border with the Third Reich. Here, he was to blaze a path to the border for the American 7th Army, commanded by General Patch, coming up from the south, and General Patton's 3rd Army advancing from the west. Franks was to do it with small raiding parties of four men in an armored jeep, who would ambush enemy convoys, destroy German fuel and ammunition dumps, and pinpoint key targets for the bombers of the RAF. In addition, he was to organize and train the local Mackie partisans into a fighting force which could effectively help the Yanks when they came into the mountains. Now, as he squatted there, listening to the soporific drone of the Halifax's engines as the plane headed out over the English Channel, he reflected on those French resistance fighters of all types and political convictions. He knew, of course, that they had done some good work since D-Day, 84 days before. But dark rumors had been flooding back to Franks's base at Wivenhoe near Colchester that all was not well with the French Maquis. There had been unpleasant tales of informers and traitors, even gangsters in their ranks, of treachery and counter-treachery, of old scores being settled, even of downright murder. In the years after the war, when Brian Franks helped to reform the disbanded Special Air Service, he never spoke much about the ill-fated Operation Layton, as this mission was codenamed. But at a late hour in the SAS drill hall in London's Duke Street, after much liquor had been consumed, he would sometimes shake his head sadly when he recalled that night of 1st and 2nd September, 1944, and say, "God, I wish we had never gone." In the second half of May, 1944, the 1st SAS Brigade had been sealed up in their pre-invasion camp at Fairford in Gloucestershire. The regime was strict. In the cage, as it became known to the troopers, with the winged dagger of the SAS, and the motto of "Who Dares Wins" on their maroon berets, it was ordered that no one was to leave on pain of years in the glasshouse, the British Army prison. Sentries were posted outside to see that they didn't. But despite all the warnings and restrictions, one member of the SAS brigade had kept disappearing from the cage. Some said 12 times in all, to reappear a few days later, looking tired but thoughtful. He was the commanding officer of the 1st SAS Regiment, Colonel Blair Main, known to his men simply as Colonel Paddy. The massive Irishman, 6'5", embroiled with it, was a sandy-haired, softly spoken ex-solicitor who had played international rugby and boxed as a heavyweight for his native country. But if Colonel Patty was softly spoken, he did have a hair-trigger temper. That temper, indeed, had first brought him to the SAS back in 1941 in Egypt, just after the Special Air Service had been formed by the future Colonel David Sterling. In the 11th Scottish Commando, with which Maine had been serving at the time, he had formed a strong dislike for his 24-year-old commanding officer, Lieutenant Colonel Geoffrey Keyes, who would soon win a posthumous Victoria Cross for his attempt to capture or kill Field Marshal Rommel. Once he had chased his CO out of the mess with a drawn bayonet. Then he committed the ultimate military sin. He struck his commanding officer. Thus, it was that Maine was languishing in a Cairo military prison, awaiting his court-martial, which would probably have resulted with his being cashiered, when a friend arranged for him to be brought under an armed escort to meet Sterling, with a view to perhaps joining the newly formed SAS. As Sterling described that meeting many years later, "He was suspicious of me from the start. We were the same age, except for a few months. But here was a man who had seen his fair share of battle and come out of it well. I probably seemed to him as a young whippersnapper who could well have been out to impress the brass." The two men discussed the new unorthodox outfit. Then, after questioning Sterling in rapid-fire style, he said, "I can't see any prospect of real fighting in this scheme of yours." Sterling answered, "There isn't any, except against the enemy." Maine laughed and said, "All right, if you can get me out of here, I'll come along." He extended a huge paw. Sterling ignored the preferred handshake. Instead, he said, "There's one more thing. This is one commanding officer you never hit, and I want you to promise that." Thereupon, he reached out his own hand. Maine's face cracked into a smile, and he said, "You have it." The legendary Paddy Maine had joined the SAS. From earlier, unauthorized jumps into occupied France to meet and assess the Maquis, Paddy Maine gained the impression that many of the French resistance were not to be trusted. He knew that many were brave men and women who were risking their lives for the cause of liberty, but he also discovered that there was suicidal feuding inside the movement. He learned, too, that many agents who had been flown in from Britain to aid the Maquis had been betrayed to the Gestapo for personal reasons, because they didn't belong to the right party, communist, or simply for money. In short, Colonel Maine didn't altogether trust the French resistance, which he was supposed to train and aid. Soon he would find out that his distrust had been well justified. Throughout June, while the Allies tried to break out of the Normandy beachhead, the 1st SAS Brigade, aided by the Maquis, fought desperately to disrupt German communications and prevent them from bringing up reinforcements to attack the beachheads, generally sabotaging German attempts to throw the invaders back into the sea. They penetrated Paris long before Leclerc's 2nd Armored Division of Patton's 3rd Army. They discovered Rommel's HQ and were planning to kill or kidnap him, as their orders read, just before he was seriously wounded by an RAF fighter bomber. Indeed, one of their subunits, the Belgian SAS, operating out of the Ardennes forest in their own country, actually penetrated Germany itself before beating a hasty and successful retreat. Within days of the D-Day landings, this small force of very brave men, working in jeep teams of 4 troopers, were operating behind German lines, from Brittany on the French coast to the Vosges Mountains in Alsace, 2,500 men operating against massive German superiority. In one case, a handful of SAS troopers, supported by local maquisards, had persuaded 1,300 German soldiers, led by a full general, to surrender to the Americans at Issoudun, were operating from 43 separate bases. June gave way to July, and the Allies had still not broken out of their Normandy beachheads. Colonel Paddy Maine's fears of French treachery were finally realized. Throughout that June, his B Squadron, led by 23-year-old Captain John Tonkin, who had already escaped from probable execution by jumping out of a German troop train in Italy, had been blowing up bridges and rolling stock in the general area of Poitiers in an attempt to help patch his 7th U.S. Army coming up from the south. On 27 June, however, two of his troopers were captured trying to destroy some marshaling yards in the area held by the German 80th Corps, made up of German reserve units, Russian Cossacks, and the 950th Indian Regiment, renegade soldiers of the British Indian Army, who, after being taken prisoner by the Germans, had gone over to them and joined the Indian Legion, Freies Indien. The two SAS prisoners refused to give their interrogators any information, but it was established that they belonged to the SAS. Immediately, General Gollenkamp, commanding 80 Corps, ordered these saboteurs and bandits to be found. The hunt for Tonkin's B Squadron was on. On the afternoon of 1 July, Trooper John Fielding was on guard at the forest camp of the SAS. "When I saw a motorcycle and sidecar being pushed down the incline towards me, along the road, by two Maki with black berets. They arrived at the track, and I laid low for a few minutes. Then I showed myself and started talking to them. They explained to me that they had got a puncture in the wheel of the sidecar, and after consideration, I took them up the track to the base where John Tonkin saw them, and the necessary repairs were carried out. They spent some time at the base." After explaining to the local Maki at Tonkin's forest hideout that they belonged to another outfit, they were allowed to leave. Naturally, both Frenchmen were spies for the Germans. Now that the enemy knew where the SAS were located, they acted promptly. A force of Gestapo, 400 SS from a training unit and a cycle reconnaissance company, under the command of Oberleutnant Vogt, a former Protestant pastor, was formed. It would have the task of launching a surprise attack on Tonkin's company and their Maki helpers. They attacked at dawn on Monday, 3 July. The outposts were attacked first as the SS men came through the trees, firing Schmeissers from the hip. Then their mortars joined in. Immediately alert, John Tonkin considered what he was to do. Firing seemed to be coming from all sides. Now he could see Germans in camouflage tunics working along the hedgerows some 200 yards off. For a few moments, he considered fighting it out with the help of the three Vickers machine guns mounted on the squadron's jeeps. But he decided against it. There were too many attackers. He went back to his men and told them they'd use their standard operating procedure in situations like this. They would scatter in ones and twos through the trees and make for the large forest to the west where they would be low. But it wasn't to be. Suddenly, a half-naked SAS trooper panicked. He ran through the group, crying at the top of his voice, "They're coming! They're coming!" His panic was infectious. A large group of maquisards and SAS troopers started to run down the slope into the valley below. Tonkin knew that this was the worst thing they could have done. He yelled at them to stand fast, but no one heeded him. So he concentrated on the men who had not panicked and began dispatching them in couples towards the large forest to the west. Suddenly, he remembered that their transmitter and the vital top-secret Cebu 4 codebook had been left behind and doubled back to get it. Too late. He saw the Germans coming in on both flanks. He was cut off. Professional as ever, he went to ground. I sat down in some rough ground, a little way down the slope and about 50 yards from the camp. The cover was very thin. Pulling up his camouflage jacket to hide his face, he froze just in time. A German carrying a Schmeisser appeared just above the top of the slope and peered into the valley, but he didn't see the concealed officer. He went away and, breathing a sigh of relief, Tonkin stole into the forest. Behind him, heavy machine guns opened up as the SS swept the trees with tracer, trying to flush out the party that had fled in panic. Captain Tonkin would never see them again alive. They shot the 30 SAS prisoners and one American who was with them on the morning of 7 July 1944. The firing squad was made up of men from the Cycle Reconnaissance Company, commanded by the former pastor Vogt. The condemned men gave their watches and other personal effects to them for safekeeping, as the Germans explained after the war. Most of them were teenagers under a senior officer, Lieutenant Crisp, all of 20, who had been wounded himself when he had stayed behind in the forest to tend a seriously wounded trooper. But, as one German observer reported after the war, the execution was accomplished militarily and with dignity. The parachutist died in an exemplary, brave, and calm manner. After the decision of the execution had been made known to them in the English language by an interpreter, the prisoners, they were not chained, stood in line, they linked arms. The fire order was given by Oberleutnant Vogt. Reporting the execution to General Gallenkamp, commander of the German 80th Corps, the officer concerned said, "General, you may be assured that this was the most terrible day and the hardest hour of my life." It was said that the reporting officer's eyes filled with tears at that moment. Vogt, who gave the firing squad the order to fire, apparently showed no emotion. After all, as they said in the German army, "Befehl ist Befehl." Orders are orders. Three of the captured SAS troopers, all in their early 20s, who had been wounded, were shamefully neglected by the German medics. Finally, they were put out of their misery by lethal injections given by the German medical officer. On the same day that the SAS troopers were shot, nine men of Paddy Maine's D Squadron were being tortured at Gestapo HQ in the Avenue Foch in Paris. Three of them, including the squadron commander, Captain Garston, were wounded and in a pitiful state from lack of blood. Pat Garston's men had dropped at a site personally selected by Maine in the great forest of Fontainebleau, not far from where the Supreme Commander, General Eisenhower, would have his HQ outside Paris. They had been unlucky. The drop had been betrayed by Maquisard in advance. As they landed, they were greeted by a group of men in civilian clothes who cried, "Vive la France!" Next moment, the Maquis had opened up with automatic weapons. After a month of torture by the Gestapo, which failed to break them, the SAS prisoners were told on 8 August by a sergeant major in the SS that they were going to be sent to Switzerland to be exchanged for German agents being held in London. He said, "As you are going via Switzerland, which is neutral, you will have to wear civilian clothes." The SS man smiled at the prisoners. But they were suspicious until the wounded Captain Garston reassured them. At midnight that day, the prisoners were led to a truck, guarded by two SS men armed with automatics. One of them spoke French, and SAS Corporal Sergei Vakulik, a Czech who had been brought up in France, tried to engage him in some friendly conversation to no avail. They set off into the night. In the moonlight, they could see, by peering through a gap in the canvas, that they were being followed by two carloads of SS men. Now, the prisoners started to get worried. Why waste precious petrol on two carloads of SS men to guard them? They weren't going to escape if they were about to be exchanged. Again, Vakulik tackled the French-speaking SS man. Were they really going to Switzerland? Gruffly, he was told to shut up. They'd learn soon enough where they were heading for. They did. A little later, the little convoy turned off the main road and headed across a field for 200 yards or so, bumping up and down over the rough pasture. Now the prisoners were afraid. This wasn't planned. What were the SS up to? The truck stopped. The prisoners were ordered out as the SS spilled out from their cars, pistols already in their hands. Alarmed, Vakulik turned to the guard who spoke French. "Are we going to be shot?" he demanded. The guard laughed. "Of course you're going to be shot. What do you think this was, a picnic?" Garston reacted promptly. He whispered to Corporal Ginger Jones to his right, "When I say now, run for it." He told Vakulik the same. The men whispered the instruction to the rest of the prisoners. A Gestapo man posted himself in front of the SAS troopers. He read something in German from a paper. None of them could understand him. It didn't matter. They were tensing for the breakout. A sergeant took the paper from the civilian and began to read in English. "For having wished to work in collaboration with the French terrorists, and thus to endanger the security of the German army, you are condemned to the penalty of death and shall be shot." Shot triggered the breakout. "Now!" Garston bellowed. They all ran for it, save Captain Garston, who was still in bad shape from his wound. The SS opened up at once. Bullets sliced the air. Five men went down at once. Captain Garston was shot where he stood. But Corporal Vakulik and Corporal Jones managed to dodge the slugs. They pelted across the field, arms working like pistons, heading for the woods beyond. And they made it. For a few days, the two fugitives hid in the village of Hermans until the Americans, advancing on Paris, finally liberated the place. Thus, it was that on 28 August, they were back at Mainz HQ, relating what had happened to the men of D Squadron, while Colonel Patty listened in silence. Now, as Colonel Franks prepared to drop, he knew from his friend Blair Main that, through betrayal by their supposed allies, the 1st SAS had paid a terrible price for helping to spearhead the attack of the two American armies marching eastwards. Would his own 2nd SAS regiment, soon to go into action in the Vosges, be betrayed too? But there was no time to think about the future now. The sergeant dispatcher had warned them they were approaching the DZ. They had a last drink from their flasks. They strapped the 100-pound kit bags to the quick-release clips below their knees. Franks positioned himself at the jump hole on the Halifax's floor. Below, in the moonlight, he could see the dark fields passing by. To the west, he glimpsed a small collection of other houses. That would be Vigny, close to the DZ. The reception party was coming from the village he knew. The dispatcher raised his right arm. The red warning light changed to green. "Go!" the RAF sergeant yelled above the roar of the engines. Colonel Franks pushed himself into space. They were on their way. 2. Betrayal. 5 hours after the SAS had landed with 3 casualties on that morning of 2 September, the commander of the army they had come to help received an urgent phone call. General Patton, at his HQ in Chalon, was summoned immediately to a meeting of the top U.S. brass at the headquarters of his chief, Bradley, in Chartres, some 130 miles away. He was expected to be there by 11 o'clock when Eisenhower would arrive, but the weather was too bad to fly, so Patton would have to go by car and at top speed. The order put Patton in a bad mood, not made any better by the thought of the way Ike had praised Montgomery on the occasion of Ike's takeover of the command of all Allied land forces the previous day. Knowing that Montgomery, who had previously held that post, had been criticized for his slowness in breaking out of the beachhead, Eisenhower had told the world press that anyone who interprets this, the command changeover, as a demotion for General Montgomery won't look facts in the face. He is not only my very close and warm friend, but one of the greatest soldiers of this or any other war.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.